Marty, wake up!
I'm so surprised to find myself
on this deserted isle.
We ran aground in Shipwreck Bay.
Repairs could take a while.
Well, Captain, let's look around. Perhaps there's some escape.
We'll take a stroll. We'll check things out. Perhaps we'll get a
map.
Map?
Look, there's a map.
Map doesn't rhyme with break. What do you...
Sun Treasure Island, VBS.
Great goobers, Captain. We've landed on...
Sun Treasure Island. It's a map. It leads to buried treasure.
Why would it do that?
Because all maps lead to buried treasure. Come on.
Sun Treasure Island is about discovering the richness of God's love as seen in 1 Corinthians 13.
Jesus' life points to 5 different truths about God's love.
God's love is giving,
kind,
caring,
forgiving,
and forever.
Wow, that's a long time.
Captain?
Something is said more than once, like it's really important. Like I'm sure everyone growing up has had somebody constantly tell them the same thing, don't do this, don't do that. But in a song I've noticed that there's something said again and again and again. I know it's kind of repetitive and seems redundant, but I think it's really, really important. So I just wanted to share that.
Amen. Well, once again, I just want to thank everybody for being here this morning. Go ahead and have a seat. We're probably going to be here about another 60 minutes. We just want to thank you again, once again, for being here. We're coming to another portion, a very important portion of our service, and a portion of our service which you get to participate in, and that is our tithes and offerings. Now, in the Gospel of Mark, who probably got most of his information from Peter, he tells a little story, something that he witnesses. It's found in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 12, verse 41, and we're going to be looking at it in our message this morning. And what he says is, Jesus sat down near their collection box in a temple and watched as the crowd dropped in their money. And again, that verse is in today's lesson, but I hear a verse like that sometimes, and I get just a little bit nervous. Because I'm thinking, if Jesus watched them then, he watches them now. But the thing is, for those of us who are believers in Christ, for those of us that are saved by faith, we understand that an offering isn't for the purpose of acceptance before God. What it is, it's a way of us showing our faith, it's a way of us showing our obedience, it's a way for demonstrating our love for Him who gave us so much. The God of riches who richly provides for us. It is a measure of love. So, if you're here today, and today's your first day here, we consider you to be our guest. And we don't ask our guests to give. It's an important part of the service. We don't take it away from anybody, but you're our guest. And if we came to your house and you offered us money, I would, or asked me for money, I'd probably be a little bit upset. So we don't ask you for anything yet. We want you to enjoy the service. We want you to enjoy the experience here. And we're hoping that you can see the living God through us, and that maybe, just maybe, the Odyssey Church will be a place that you want to hang out just a little bit more. So as the ushers come forward, allow me to pray for you. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the group of people that have come here today. Those that are fathers, and maybe those who have had a struggle with their relationship with the Father, and those who have lost their Father, Lord, let today be a day of rejoicing. Because no matter what, we have a Heavenly Father that looks down upon us with so much love that He gave His only Son. Because that's what people do for love. They did. And you gave us what was most important to you, your one and only Son. So Father, as we come to today's message, Lord, I just ask that you'll speak through me, that through me, people can see Jesus. Lord, I thank you and praise you for the opportunity to speak your word. Never let me take it for granted. I thank you for the people that are here. Never let me take them for granted. We love you and thank you in the precious name of our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Change your name to Rich and then you'll be Mr. Rich.
Be a lawyer. They always seem to have money.
Marry a guy named Rich and then you'll be Mrs. Rich.
Hello.
Marry an old rich man, wait until he dies, and then you'll be even richer.
Great godmother, and have your grandchild wish to be rich.
Buy life insurance for your brother and kill him.
Drive to casino, put all your chips on the table, and win big.
Have a lot of pets, name them all money, then you have money, money, money.
Come to the Odyssey for the new summer series on how to be rich.
Money makes the world go around, the world go around, the world go around. Money.
You didn't realize that we had so much talent in this church, did you?
I do not know that.
Well, good morning once again, and welcome to the Odyssey Church on this wonderful Father's Day. And I have really the honor of being really schooled by my kids today, so I'm so grateful for that. I hope everybody's had a great day so far, and I especially want to welcome those that are here for the first time, or maybe for some of you who haven't been here in a long time. We just really appreciate you being here, and maybe today is just like the perfect day to be here, because if you've ever had trouble in your finances, if maybe you're having a difficult area in your finances, today I want to give you a simple, simple, simple plan to handle your finances. A plan to help you make better decisions, and a plan to help you live with fewer regrets. Now this is going to be free financial advice, and it's great not because it's free, and it's great not because I'm the one telling you. It's grace because I believe that it's based on Scripture. And whether you believe, as I do or not, that the Scriptures are God-breathed, that they're inspired, or whether you don't believe that, no one can deny that the Scriptures give you a lot of great information on how to live your life. And that includes our financial life. And the great thing about the advice that's in it, it works whether you believe Jesus is who He says He is or not. great part about the Bible is if you apply this teaching to your life, it will work. And what my hope and my prayer is, maybe for some of you, is that you will follow and find Jesus through this. That as you follow His Word, that you'll see that Jesus is exactly who He says He is, and that you will make Jesus the Lord and Savior over your life. Now, we're in the third part of the series we're calling How to Be Rich. And we're not talking about how to get rich. There's a lot of people that tell you how to get rich. There's a lot of places you go on the internet and infomercials, and there's a lot of books written about how to get rich. But there's not a lot of people telling you how to be rich. And there's even less people telling you how to be good at being rich. Now, the reason we're talking about how to be rich, and again, this series is taken from a book called How to Be Rich. It's written by a man named Andy Stanley, and it's based on a series of sermons that he spoke at his church at North Point in Atlanta, Georgia. So I want to be transparent. I want to give credit where credit is due. I sort of put it together in my own words, but it's based a lot on his book. And it was a series and a book that changed my life. But the reason we're talking about how to be rich is because most rich people are just really bad at being rich. And if you like today's message, or maybe you missed some of our messages, you can always go to our website, www.odysseythechurch.com, and you can watch them there. And they're there for free as long as you have internet and a device to watch them on. Or if you know somebody who's rich and they're really bad at being rich, invite them over for dinner. And just happen to have this playing on your YouTube channel when you walk in. Just don't tell them I'm the one that told you to do that, okay? Now, the other reason we're doing this series is we discovered in the very first week, many of us. In fact, I believe most of us in this room have actually moved. We have crossed the line from non-rich to rich, and we didn't even know it. And the definition of rich is simply having more than what we need. We have an abundance. We have more than we need. And the United States is the richest and the most abundant country on earth. And we have more than we need. We have more food. We have bigger houses. We have more cars than we need. So therefore, by the definition of rich, all of us in this room are rich. Now part of the problem is we don't feel rich. According to statistics, on a global level, everybody in here just isn't rich. They are super rich. And I would bet there's people in here today that not only are rich by the world standards, they're rich by our own country standards. So in the first week, we had to admit what we already were. We had to admit that God has blessed me with more than I need, so therefore I'm rich. And we said this together, so let's practice this one more time, because we have to admit what we are. We got little bracelets and everything now. Let's say it together. God has blessed me with more than I need, so therefore I am rich. And you know what? Sometimes I feel just a little bit uncomfortable to say that I am rich. I mean, we feel like we're telling a lie for some of us, and for some of us, we feel like maybe it's egotistical, but the evidence, what it really says is that we're rich. And most of them don't feel rich. In fact, if I was to guess, I bet there's a lot of people here that not only don't feel rich, they feel financial pressure. Yet most of the world would look at us and say, if I just had a third of what you have, if I just made a tenth of what you make, I would feel like I was rich. But the reason that we can move from not rich to rich is because we don't feel rich. We feel pressure. And feeling rich, and you may not believe this, but feeling rich has nothing to do with how much money you make. Feeling rich. Think about it. When was the time you felt like you were the richest? You know, I remember I was probably about 8 or 9 years old. And I was saving up for a stereo. And I had $132 in the bank. And none of my friends had $132 in the bank. And I felt richer than any of them. Why? Because I didn't have any bills. I lived at home with my mom, and my bank account was growing. So the moral of the story is, get a job and move back home with your mom and dad. Right. I'm not sure if that's the first hand clap I got here, but I'm not sure it's the right reason either. But here's the why most of us don't feel rich, and it has nothing to do with how much money you make. It has to do with margin. We feel rich when we have margin. And the reason we don't feel rich is because we have a lack of margin. Margin simply means the amount that's available beyond what is necessary. So you can feel rich and not make a lot of money because you have a lot of money left over because you don't have a lot of bills. But because we live so close, we live so close to what we make, in a lot of cases, we live above what we make. We don't have any margin, so therefore we don't feel rich. Our more stuff that we desire, we're not able to afford it. When emergencies happen, the pressure begins to set in. And there's a lot of Americans, maybe even a lot of Americans that are in here today, that not only live way up to the edge, they live over the edge. They live on more than they make, and that's why credit card debt is so high in the United States. We borrow from our future income so we can have the things that we want now that we can't afford. So not only do we not feel rich, we feel this incredible pressure, and for some of you, you probably make more money than you ever dreamed about, and yet you still have this pressure because you don't have any margin. So here at the Odyssey Church, we want you to know, no matter where you're at financially, you are a have and not a have-not. We want you not to know how to get rich. Most of us have already passed the line from not rich to rich. We may not even know it, we may not feel it, but we passed that line. But we want you to know how to be good at rich so that you can act rich, so that you can feel rich, and so that you can be rich in a way that glorifies our Heavenly Father. Amen. So we've been looking at these three verses in 1 Timothy chapter 6, and you may want to turn there in your Bible. If you don't have a Bible, we've got plenty up here. They're free. They're our gifts to you, because what we know, if you take the Bible and you read it and you apply it to life, you will live life and you will live it more abundantly, and you'll live richer and more full than you ever dreamed about. Now, we've been looking at these three verses, 1 Timothy chapter 6, 17, 18, and 19, and they were written by a man named Paul, who was rich, but became poor, lost everything he had because he decided to follow Jesus Christ at a time and a place when it was illegal to be a Jesus follower. And he's writing to a young man by the name of Timothy. Now, Timothy was his mentor. Timothy had been traveling around the world, or around the world as they knew it at that time, and they were planning or launching or starting new churches all over the place. And so Paul writes this letter to his friend Timothy, and he says to Timothy, teach. Or as we have seen before, the Greek word is actually a lot stronger than just teach. The Greek word means to command. Command those who are rich in this present world. And when we've already seen, as we already know, as we found out in the first week, Timothy's writing to us. He's writing to the rich people. And if you live in the United States of America and you have a bed and a home and you have a refrigerator, you're richer than most of the people in the entire world. So we've learned that even though we may not feel rich, we are. We may feel a little awkward talking about the fact that we're rich. Many of us even deny the fact they're rich. But most of us have passed the line from not rich to rich. We're the ones Paul's writing to Timothy about. And now Paul tells Timothy to warn us that rich has side effects. There are things that happen to you when you learn that you're rich. And the problem is, we look at these verses and we say, Timothy, tell these rich people, and we sort of tune it out because we don't think we're rich. But Paul's writing to us. He says, teach or command those who are rich in this world not to be proud, not to be arrogant, not to trust in their money, not to trust in their possessions. Again, the Greek word sort of means stuff. Don't trust in your money. Don't trust in your possessions. Don't trust in your stuff, which is so unreliable and so uncertain. It can be here today and gone tomorrow. See, rich people, affluent people, they have something that's very similar to the flu. Now, when you have flu, the doctor says you have influenza. Affluent people have affluenza. And the infected person, you know, when you have the flu, how miserable you feel? Well, when you have influenza, you don't feel bad, but you make everybody around you feel bad. If wealth was like an over-the-counter drug, it had a strong warning label attached to it. Say something like this. Warning, wealth may cause arrogance, conceit. This product can make you think more of yourself than you're worth. It may cause you to be high-minded. While taking this medicine, take extra precaution should be taken so that you don't offend people. And if taken for a prolonged amount of time, your perception will change, causing your hope to migrate into this product. See, here's a fact. Here's what we all know. As our self-worth goes up, or as our self-wealth goes up, so does our self-worth. As our wealth and our riches go up, so does our ego. And all of a sudden, rich people begin to think they're entitled to things that non-rich people don't get. Rich people start to think think that they should be treated differently than the non-rich people. Rich people think that maybe they're smarter than non-rich people. And their hope and their trust begins to migrate, begins to move from God into their stuff. You can't go in two directions at one time. So their hope begins to migrate from God and start to move towards their riches. Somebody said, wealth is like seawater. The more you drink it, the more you want it. Wealth has an insatiable appetite. It's never fully, it's never satisfied completely. So as our hope begins to migrate or move away from God into our stuff, a strange thing starts to happen. Our hands begin to close around our stuff. Because we believe our stuff, if we have enough of it, will lead to safety. So we start to close our hands around it because our hope is somehow in our stuff that we can save, and you think that you can save your way into safety. So Paul writes this letter to Timothy, and he tells them to tell us rich people to watch out for the side effects of wealth. And don't put your hope in your riches, but in the one who richly provides. Teach, command those who are rich in this world not to be proud, arrogant, and not to trust in their money, possessions, which are so unreliable and so uncertain. Their trust should be in God, who richly gives, who richly provides us all we need for our enjoyment. Now that is great news. It's great news because if God has blessed you, you don't have to feel guilty for being blessed. If you're a rich person, you don't have to feel guilty for being rich. He's given it to you for a reason. He's given it to you for your enjoyment. But we do need to learn how to be good at having stuff. We have to learn to be good at being rich. We have to learn at being good at being rich, and good at being rich is an acquired skill. It's something that takes discipline and instruction and practice. The problem with wealth is unreliable and it's uncertain. And at the end of your life, and we all know this, at the end of life, you can't, because nobody can, put your hope in your riches. At the end of our life, we all know that our riches are no good to us. At the end of our life, our riches go away because we go away. So we left you with this challenge last week. If you're going to put your hope in God at the end, why not put your hope in God now? If you're going to put your hope in God at the end of your life, why not put your hope in God now? And then we added another statement to the one we had in the first week. The first week we had to admit that we were already rich. God has blessed me with more than I need, so therefore I am rich. And Paul has told us wealth has side effects, and one of the side effects of wealth is we put our hope in what we have more than we put our hope in God who gave us what we have. So we added this. Maybe we can all repeat this together. God has blessed me with more than I need, so therefore I am rich. I will not place my hope in my riches, but in Him who richly provides.
Amen.
So if there's side effects to wealth, and we know that there are, how do we protect ourselves from those side effects? And if the side effects of our riches have already become present in our life, what's the cure? Well, Paul tells Timothy there is an antidote. There is an antidote to the side effects of wealth. There's a way to immunize ourselves from the side effects of wealth. So this is the part that Paul's getting ready to explain, and he's going to tell us how not to be angry and arrogant, how not to put our hope in our riches, and how not to put our hope in our stuff, but how to put our hope in the one who richly provides. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to pick up where we left off in 2 Timothy chapter 6, and I'm going to read this entire passage again, and then we'll pick up where we left off last week, and we'll go on with our study. So, command those who are rich in this world not to be arrogant, and not to trust in their money, which is so unreliable and so uncertain. Their trust should be in God, which richly gives, richly provides us for all we need for our enjoyment. Now, Paul's not telling Timothy to tell rich people to just be good. You know, the first two lessons, what he's saying is, admit that you're rich, and understand being rich has side effects. So don't put your hope in your riches, but put your hope in God, who so richly provides. Now Paul comes to verse 18, and he says, tell them, again the word is actually command, command them being the rich people, command rich people to use their money to do good. Now Paul's not telling us to be good, because the rest of the Bible tells us to be good. Remember, Paul's talking to rich people. And he's telling rich people, he's saying, I don't even want you to use your money to do good like an average person. We all know we're supposed to use our money for good. The Bible tells us that, right? He said, I don't want you to do it like an average person does it. He says, you're not average. I want you to use your money to do good like only a rich person can use their money to do good. This isn't average do good. This is rich do good. This is good only like a rich person can do good. And in case we didn't understand what Paul was saying, he repeats it again. And for instance, he begins to define what it means to use for good. He says, they, the rich people, should be rich in good works, should be rich in good deeds. Now this is huge. This is huge. Because Paul is telling Timothy to tell rich people, remember, statistically, that's all of us. Paul's telling us, in effect, he's telling Timothy to tell us, don't be average good. None of us should be average good. He says, take your extra time and the extra money you have and figure out how to use it for God and others as only a rich person could do. Here's what Paul knew about rich people. Here's what we know about rich people. Most of them don't just have extra time or extra money. They have extra time as well. Now, just like we feel we don't have any extra money, we feel like we don't have any extra time either. But we do. Most people work a 5-day work week, get 2 days off. Most of us get vacation time or comp time or personal days. It's unheard of in most of the world. But even if you work a 60-hour work week and you sleep 8 hours a night, you still have 52 hours a week of discretionary time. If you get 8 hours sleep a night, work a 60-hour work week, you still have 52 hours left over to do whatever you want to do. And even though we don't feel like we have any extra time, in actuality, we do. But even though we have all this extra time, statistically, we spend less of our extra time serving God and serving others. And surveys which are done, the less extra time a person has, the more percentage of that time they use for serving God and others. And the more extra time a person has, the less time they use to serve God and others. It's the same way with money. The more money somebody makes, the less percentage of their money they give away. The more money a person has, the less of a percentage of that money they give away. You'd think it'd be the other way around. They got more money, they'll give more percentage away, but it's not. It's the exact opposite. But as we gain wealth, and as we gain possessions, as we begin to accumulate these riches, the temptation is that our hope starts to migrate towards our stuff and away from God, and because our hope is in our stuff, our hands begin to close around our stuff. Because you begin to try and save your way into safety. Poor people know they can't do that, so they just give it away. There's no hope. But rich people, they just hold on to it tightly. And as we saw, the richest man ever to live, King Solomon, says that's like trying to scale an unclimbable wall. Our natural tendency is to have to save our way into safety, so we begin to close our hands around our stuff to bring us safety. And Solomon says there is no way that you can have enough to save your way into safety, because it's like an eagle. It can grow wings and fly away. So rich people give larger sums, but they give away smaller percentages. Rich people give away larger sums, but they give away a smaller percentage. They give away more dollars, but they give away a less percentage of their dollars than not rich people. And Jesus tells us, as we're going to see in a few minutes, it's not what you have that matters, it's what you do with what you have that matters. See, the thing is, here's why. Rich people are rich in options. They have money and they have time. So they go to ball games, they go to movies, they go out to dinner, they go out to vacations. They play golf on the weekends, they play tennis. And when somebody comes and says, hey, you want to do this with me? They don't have to say no because they don't have the money. They just go. The more money a person has, the less percentage of their money they give away and the less of their extra time they use for God and others. And it's easy for us at the end of our life, the end of our lifetime or at the end of the year, to have a large sum of money in the bank, but we've not been rich in good works because we live in a culture, we live in a time that tells us all our extra time and all our extra money is for us. And we've been programmed to think that we take all our extra time and all our extra money and fill it with pleasures for ourselves. Now, I also know when a pastor or a preacher starts talking about money in church, people start thinking that they want their money. And I promise you, we're not taking another offering. We're not starting a capital funding campaign. We're not going in. I just want you to get a hold of what Paul's about to tell you, because it will change the way you serve God and others, and it will change the way you handle your money, and you will live richer and fuller and more abundantly if you can just grasp this into your heart. Now, if all this Paul had been telling us is not convicting enough, Paul goes on to tell us the antidote for the generous or for the side effects of being rich. This is how you inoculate yourself from being arrogant and letting your hope drift away from God and into your stuff. He says, tell them, command them to use their money to do good. They, the rich people, us, should be rich in good works, rich in good deeds, and be generous. Be generous to those in need, always being ready to share with others. Paul says, if you want to avoid it, if you want to avoid the side effects of wealth, if you want to be good at being rich, you have to be generous. Generous with your time, generous with your money. And we all read this and we think, well, I give and I share. I must be the one he's talking about. I'm the generous one. But Paul says, I'm not talking to average people. I'm talking to rich people. And I want you to be generous with your time and with your money, as only rich people can be generous with their time and their money. Whatever average is, I want you to go way, way, way beyond that. Because you're not average, you're rich. And you may not feel rich, and you may be average in your culture, but you're not average according to the world. And I want you to give to your very fullest potential like only a rich person can. I want you to develop a lifestyle of generosity. Now, one of the problems with the word generous is it's as hard to define generous as it is to define who's rich and who's not rich. Everybody thinks they're not rich, but everybody thinks they are generous. It's a fact. None of us think we're rich, but we all think we're generous, right? Somebody comes to you and says, are you generous? You're not going to say, no, I'm as stingy as anything. There's no real grading system. It's like being in a gym. You know, you just show up and you get a body, you get a C. You don't have to do anything. There's no real grading system for generous. You know, you throw a couple dollars in the plate on Sunday morning, you give a homeless person a couple dollars to buy a meal, you smile at a stranger, you give directions to a tourist, and you feel good about what you've done, and you think you're generous. Now that's true, you're generous, but you're not the kind of generous that vaccinates you against the side effects of wealth. For that kind of generosity, you need some guidelines to follow. You need some principles to follow. You need some prescriptions to take. Because we all know if we don't take prescriptions, if we don't have any guidelines, if there's no principle to follow on how to give of our time and our money, this is how we do it. We do it spontaneously, when we feel like it, sporadically, if there's enough emotion involved, and sparingly, just enough to make us feel good. That's how we give. If you don't have a plan to give and use your extra time, you will give spontaneously, sporadically, and sparingly. And the problem with this type of giving is, first of all, it gives you a false sense of generosity. I gave, I served, so I'm generous. But the facts say the more a person has in time and in money, the less percentage of their time and the less percentage of their money they give away, so they feel generous. And they are, but not the kind of generous Paul's talking about, and your heavenly Father desires. Second, this type of giving, spontaneous, sporadically, and sparingly, never makes a true difference. You know, you buy a couple boxes of Girl Scout cookies, and you feel good because you helped a little girl out. But let's face facts. If you didn't buy any two boxes of cookies, Girl Scouts ain't going out of business. You buy a homeless person a meal, and you feel good because you bought a homeless person a meal. They're not going to starve to death because they miss one meal. They miss a lot of meals. You serve one day in a volunteer organization, and you feel good. But if you didn't serve that one time on that one day, they're not going to have to close their doors. You feel good, but you've not really made a difference. And when you give spontaneously, sporadically, and sparingly, your heart never moves. It feels good for a little while, but your heart is still with yourself and not with God. And Jesus said, where your heart is, there also is your treasure. So the way to give of our time and our money, like God wants us to give, and how to counter the side effects of wealth so our heart begins to migrate towards God and not always to follow. And first of all, what we need to do is we need to pre-decide, pre-plan, pre-determine that we're going to do it. We have to pre-decide a portion of our time, a percentage of our money, to give away. And if you don't pre-decide, you just won't do it. Your intentions will always be good, but you'll never follow through. So how do we become this generous servant, this generous giver, become rich in our generosity, like Paul's telling Timothy to tell us to do, to command us to do and to be? How do we become a generous servant, a generous giver that counters the side effects of being rich? The first thing we have to do is we have to pre-decide to do it. We have to pre-decide before we get a day off, before we get our vacation, before we get our paycheck to do certain things, because the natural tendency is to be spontaneous, sporadic, and sparing server and giver. We think all our stuff is us, for us. The assumption is it's for our consumption. And if we don't pre-decide to serve and give to God and others, they end up getting our leftovers. That's all they get. And God makes it very clear in His Word, both in the Old Testament and the New Testament, He does not want our leftovers. He wants our best. And He knows when we put Him first and we give Him our best, not only are we giving the way He desires us to give, but He has our hearts. And when He has our hearts, He has us. Think about this. You have a special guest over for dinner. Your boss is coming over for dinner. Maybe it's your girlfriend's family for the first time. You know, maybe it's a family member you haven't seen in years, and you tell them to come over, we're going to have a nice dinner for you. You don't go to your refrigerator and say something like, I got all these leftovers. What do you want? I got half-eaten chicken in here. I got some pork, but you know what? You better smell it first. It's been in a couple weeks. Ain't nobody in this house like peas. There are plenty of peas. I can heat them up for you. What do you want? Oh, you don't give your guests leftovers. Your leftovers are for you. You want to do that. And if you don't pre-decide, if you don't predetermine, you don't pre-plan about your time and your money, you end up giving God and others your leftovers. And the people you care the most about, the kingdom of God, the world, get your leftover time and your leftover money. And that's not how to be good at being rich. That's how you be bad at being rich. When it comes to our time, the easiest way to do it is pick a portion of your time. Pick a portion of your time. And you pick a cause, an organization that you believe in, you believe that's making a difference in the world. And I believe you should, you know, we try to pick organizations that are right here in the community we live in, or near the community we live in, that are making a difference. And then you pre-decide how many hours you're gonna serve there. How many hours are you gonna serve God and others? Pre-decide what you're going to do with a certain portion of your time, and then commit to doing it, and then stick with it. Stop being a spontaneous, sporadic, and sparing server, and become a strategic and systematic server. Have a system for giving. Now you think about it. I want you to think about this, all of you who come every week. You know, if you're new here, you may not know this, but the reason this church works, and the reason we're having this explosion here, last week we were blessed. We baptized 8 people, first time baptisms. We had 2 people rededicate their life to Christ. We got to do a baby dedication. That's 11 people. We're just having a little mini revival here at the Odyssey Church. And that's because we have a group of people that have all pre-decided an allotment of their time to make sure all this works. That's why this church is clean when you come in. We have people who pre-decided to help us out. That's why there's food and coffee ready when you arrive. We've got people who pre-decided to help us out. The music team takes 2 or 3 days of their week. They practice at home. They practice here so the music's ready. We have people in the back in the tech booth to make sure the words on the PowerPoint, when the devil doesn't get into the computer, and make sure the message on the PowerPoint, the message on the music all match up. They're not spontaneous servers. They are systematic servers. They don't say, you know, I might come to church on Sunday morning and I might help out. They don't get up on Sunday morning and say, you know, you want to go to church today? Do you really feel like messing with those kids today? You know, I don't know if I feel like singing this week. Let's not do it. In fact, let's just play it by ear every week. Now, can you imagine what kind of chaos would be here if that happened? Can you imagine what kind of disaster Sunday mornings would be if that was the case? You're blessed, I'm blessed, the people in this community are blessed because we have a group of people right here at the Odyssey Church that have pre-decided to give a portion of their time, pre-decided to volunteer and serve God and serve you and serve this community and serve this church. Now again, this isn't to give you any kind of guilt, but can you imagine? Can you just imagine if more of you decided, pre-decided, to serve and volunteer? If somebody was outside parking the cars so they were nice and orderly and they were welcoming the guests as soon as they opened their door, they're greeting every person, especially our first-time guests in the parking lot before they ever got in the door. Or somebody was out front when the guests started to arrive at our information booth and they would answer their questions before they were ever asked. Or if we had more people to attend to our most special guests, our children. Can you imagine how people would begin to view our church? Can you imagine how people might even begin to view Christians and Christianity? Now, volunteering in a church isn't for you, I understand. I appreciate that. I got that. People have different talents. People have different likes. But pre-decide to serve somewhere. It doesn't have to be here. It doesn't have to be in a church. But pre-decide somewhere, maybe even two somewhere. Choose an organization that's making a difference and get involved and help them make even a bigger difference. Now, when it comes to our finances, like serving, we must pre-decide to give. And this part, I'm going to tell you, this part is so simple. So simple. Yet if you get a hold of it, if you can just get this one teaching, if you don't grasp any other point, if you don't get anything else out of this message, if you get this, your entire financial life will change. Percentage giving. Pre-decide a percentage of your income to give away. God does not care about how much money you give to him. He just simply doesn't care. What he cares about is the percentage of money you give. We get impressed by how much money we give God, but God gets impressed by the percentage we give. We're impressed because we know how much we used to give and how much we're giving now. We get impressed because we see a lot of zeros on the end of a check. We get impressed because we think we know what others give and we think we give more than they give. But I can assure you, you don't. And I'll say that sarcastically. Most people in this room will never know the number one contributor to the Odyssey Church. Because that family does not attend the Odyssey Church. They think you should wear suits and ties and dresses when you come to church. They don't like the music we play. Some of you are going to find this really, really hard to believe, and I know that. They think I speak too long.
What's that?
What I'm thinking. But you know what? They believe in what we're doing so much, and they've seen the evidence of what we're doing. They decided to give a percentage of their income. They decided to get involved to the point that they pay our rent every single month for the past year. Every month. Because they said, we don't want to just get involved. We want to throw a dollar in the bank. We want to get involved to the point that we can make a difference. And they have. And there's people in this room today that have benefited from that. People in here today that have benefited both in this world and the next world because somebody decided to give a percentage of their income to the point that they could make a difference. They pre-decided. They wanted not just to give, but give enough to make a difference. And they are rich people that know how to be rich. But the ironic thing is, they probably make less than most people in here. But they have margin. And you will probably never guess, it's not who you think it is, that's the second largest contributor to our church. It's just the way it is. We get impressed with zeros. God does not. So not only do you have to pre-decide, and not only do you have to be a percentage giver, you need to be a progressive giver. We need to pre-decide. We need to give and to serve. How many hours we're going to serve, what portion we're going to serve, and how, what percentage of our money we're going to give, okay? And then we need to be progressive in the way we serve and the way we give. We need to increase our giving and our serving little by little over time. Many of us grew up in church, and we've been giving the same amount of giving for years. Our lifestyles have changed for the better. We live better than we ever have, but we're still giving the same percentage we used to give. We're giving the same amount that we used to give. Nothing's changed. And I believe that not only should you pre-decide how much to give and a portion and a percentage to give, but I think that your giving should be progressive. If your lifestyle is getting better, but your giving is the same as it was years ago, you're not being generous like God tells you to be generous, like God wants you to be generous. Rich people should do more and give more, and not just in dollars, but percentages. To be generous, as Paul describes generous, to be generous like only a rich person can be generous, we must pre-decide a portion of our extra time and a percentage of our money, take a percentage and give it away, and then as you get more, be progressive in what you do and what you give. See, here's a fact. There's only really a couple things we can do with our money. Now, I know there's a lot of people here a lot smarter than I am. Maybe you'll think of something else. But when we look at our money, it really all just boils down to about five things. We can spend it. We all like to do that, right? We can repay our debt. We don't like to do that, but we do. We can pay our taxes. I don't think anybody likes to pay taxes. We can save it, or we can give it away. Most Americans, probably most people in here, not only is this what we do with our money, this is the order that we do it in. That means if I don't spend it all, and if the government doesn't take it all, I might save a little bit to spend later, and if by some kind of great miracle there's anything left over, I might give some to God and others. We put ourselves first, and God and others last. Now, when we get into a financial crisis, this doesn't keep us. In fact, we don't even hesitate to go to God and say, can you help me out of my mess? Can you help me pay my bills? You know the cell phone that I had to have with the internet service? And my new car payment? And you know it's so high because I'm upside down on that old car that I traded in and was still working. I had to have something nicer newer. You know that. God, will you help me a new job or a better job? God, can you help me out? I just can't seem to get my way out of this debt that I created by buying stuff that I wanted and I didn't have the money to buy, so I put it on the credit card and it just followed me up. Lord, I just wanted it. God, please help me in my finances. Don't you think God sometimes just wants to say, help me what? You know, God, help, take care of me. Oh, and if there's anything left, you know, I'll give a little to you. Can you help me? Can you move in my direction, God? Don't you think God just says, you know, sure, you know, I know that sometimes when they pass the ad at the office, they can throw a couple dollars in. When the bucket church comes by, they might throw a five in, maybe a dollar or two. But really, isn't that like giving me your leftovers? I mean, you pretty much keep me out of your finances, and yet you come to me when you get in financial trouble. I don't want your leftovers. I want you. And I can't have you unless I know I have your money, because that's the number one competitor for our hearts is our money. Most of us have a habit when it comes to our money. We get paid, we do pretty much the same thing, don't we? We pay and do pretty much the same thing every time we get paid. And if we get extra money, we do what people do with extra stuff. We waste it. We buy something we want. We do something we weren't able to do. We do a little extra. The credit card companies, they have a plan. Your loan companies, your car company, your landlord, your mortgage, all those people have a plan. They have a system to get the money out. They send you a monthly bill, don't they? The government, they have a system for getting your money. You either have to pay taxes through an employer or through self-employment taxes. You have to do a year-end filing. Everybody has a system for your money. But most of us don't have a system for our own money for us. We give spontaneously, based on emotion, sporadically, based on who's asking, and sparingly, just enough to make us feel good. Now, if there's a system for our spending, and a system for our loan repayment, and a system for to pay our taxes, shouldn't we have a system to save and give it away? If there's a system for everything else, shouldn't we have a system for us? Now, well, here it is again. When we think sometimes that all cash flow is our money. I'm not asking for your money. If you don't want to give, your gift somewhere else. We believe that if this is of God, God will provide. You'll say, that's what I learned. All they do is talk about money. I want you to know God and people at the Odyssey Church. We don't want anything from you. We want something for you. Of course, we have bills to pay. I'm not going to deny that. We don't charge you to come through the door. We don't get a cover charge. You don't check your ID when you come in. You know, we have bills to pay. But if this is to be, God will provide. It's not about getting your money. God wants your heart. He wants you. God says, I want to be number one in your life. And God knows my heart. And he knows your heart. And he don't want to be number five. And he don't want to be number four. God don't even want number three or number two. God wants to be number one in your life. When we trust Him as Lord over our finances, we will trust Him as Lord over our life. And God knows that. And I want you to know that it's easy to tell what you're in love with. It's easy to tell where your heart is. All you have to do is look at your checkbook. And you look where you're spending your money. If you want to know what you're most concerned about, look at what you're giving most of your money to. You know this. I know this. God knows this. And Paul says the way to keep the side effects of wealth from taking over is to be generous with your time and your money. It's all about priority. God doesn't want to be number five, number four, number three, number two. God wants to be number one. In fact, God demands to be number one. How insulting it must be to God when we put Him way, way, way down the list. And then we go to Him when we get in trouble. When we get into a bind, He's always the first one we go to. Help me, help me, help me, God. Move in my direction. And God must think to Himself, why don't you just move in my direction and see what I can do for you? Do you think for a second that the God of the heavens and the earth, the God of everything seen and unseen, the God who created everything and tells us everything belongs to Him, is impressed about how many zeros are on your check? Of course not. Jesus tells us what impresses God, what moves God, is the percentage of what we give, not the amount. And He gives us an example of this in Scripture. It's found in Mark chapter 12, verse 41 through verse 44. And if you heard this story before, which I know a lot of you have, if you've heard this story before, it's easy to miss that this is about percentage giving. It's easy to miss that this is not about the money a person gives, it's about the percentage they give. This is a story about rich people who are bad at being rich. They're arrogant. They have had preoccupation with their wealth, and this has caused their hope to migrate towards their stuff and away from God, and they're suffering from the side effects of wealth, while this poor widow is faithfully practicing generosity. He starts out, Jesus sat down near the collection booth in a temple and watched as the crowds dropped in their money. Many rich people put in large amounts. Then a poor widow came and dropped in two small copper coins. See, back in those days, they didn't pass a plate like we do here. There was an offering box outside the door, and you gave as you came in or as you came out. And rich people would come in, and they would make a big extravaganza about how much money they would give. They'd make sure the coins jingle and people saw them. They would come in, and they'd be fancy in their clothes. So Jesus sits down, and He calls His disciples and says, come here, boys. Come on, boys. I want you to watch this. And He says, Jesus called His disciples to Him and said, I tell you the truth. This poor widow has given more than all the others who are making contributions, for they gave a tiny part of their surplus. They gave a tiny percentage of what they own. But she, as poor as she is, has given everything she had to live on. They gave a tiny percentage. She gave a large percentage. And because she gave a large percentage, Jesus says, she's given more than everybody else. It's not how much you give. It's the percentage you give. Jesus watched these rich people put in these large amounts, and the poor people put in as much as they could. And Jesus takes note of the rich people and their fancy clothes and how they could make sure all the people could see the fact that they were dumping in so much money, and they felt arrogant. They felt superior to everyone else. And not to mention, if you look at verse 40 right before this, Jesus told these rich people, you shamelessly cheat widows out of their property. And then Jesus watches this little lady alongside of his disciples. She hobbles up to the offering plate and just drops in these two small copper coins. And my understanding is the Greek word didn't even have a word. They had to invent a word because it was so small. There was no explanation to it. It was almost embarrassing how little she put in compared to everybody else. And yet Jesus says she gave more than all the others. Jesus is showing us. He's showing our disciples. He's showing us that it is not the amount you give. The percentage means more than the sum. The percentage you give means more than the sum you give. If you want to be generous, We want to be generous the way Paul tells us to be generous, the way Jesus tells us in the New Testament to be generous, the way God tells us in the Old Testament to be generous, the way to counter the side effects of wealth, that percentage matters more than a son. Yeah, I know we're running late, and I apologize for that, but I got a lot of words to get out, and I'm going to get them out as fast as I can. As I told you before, you know, I used to hang around a lot with some rich people. I used to hang around some people that were wealthy. And I'm sort of glad that I did, because they make great sermon illustrations. And they don't usually, and you'd think that would be the other way around. But it's not. So I had this person I'm close to, he made about $180,000 to $200,000 a year. And to me, that's a lot of money. It may not be a lot of money. Some people here, it's a lot of money to me. And one of the side effects is his wealth were in absolutely full room. He is sort of being arrogant. He's telling me how much money he gives away every year at the end of the year. He gives to charity so he can get the tax rate off. He said, every year I give $2,000 away. I set aside, just give away. And the first thought was, well, first of all, you're not giving it away out of benefit for God and others. You're giving it away because you want tax write off. You're not giving it away for anybody else. You're giving it away for you. But I didn't say it. I said, you mean to tell me if all your wealth, you only give 1% of what you make? And he said, of course I do. It's mine. I'm not giving it away. Now he's thinking he's giving a lot away. Don't misunderstand me. $2,000 is a lot of money. But to him, it was dropping bucket. It was pocket change to him. Do you think God was impressed by my friend's $2,000? I don't think God was impressed. That's why this series is not about how to get rich. It's about how to be rich. Because the good news is most of us, if not all of us, have passed over the line from not rich to rich. We're already rich by the world's sound. You're eating and you're living indoors and you have a bed to sleep in. That's rich to most of the world. This isn't about getting rich. This is about how to be good at being rich by reprioritizing your finances so you can have a sense of peace so that you can welcome God into this area of your life. And if you can embrace it, what I'm about to tell you, you can have peace that comes with knowing who is truly your hope. You can have peace of knowing what it feels like, to be rich. And feeling rich has absolutely nothing to do with how much money you make or how much stuff you have. It has to do with how much margin you have. For most of us, we prioritize our money like this. Spend it, repay it, pay taxes, save it, give it away. We spend it. That's about me. I'm going to get what I need first. I'm going to get what I want first. And then we're going to repay our debt. That's about us too. I've got to pay for the things I couldn't afford at the time I wanted them, so I borrowed against my future earnings. We have to pay taxes. Now, a lot of us think that paying the taxes is about the government. Really, that's about us too. Because we don't want the repercussions. We want to have to face what might happen if we don't pay our taxes. That's really about us too. And if then, by some kind of miracle, we might save a little bit so that we can buy stuff in the future for us. And if I, you know, by chance, if there's anything left over after me, I might give some of my leftovers to God and others. Does that sound about right? Now you fry. God tells us that we need to flip the order. We just need to flip the order. We have to give it away. We have to save it. We have to pay our taxes. We have to repay our debt. And then we spend it. We give God's kingdom first. We save for our kingdom second. We pay our taxes. You know, give to God what is God. Give to Caesar what is Caesar's. We repay our debt next. And as you reprioritize your finances in this order, what you're going to begin to see is what a demon debt is. And finally, you readjust your lifestyle to live on what's left over. But in order to do this, you have to pre-decide, you have to pre-plan, you have to predetermine you're going to do it, and then you have to commit to sticking to you. And I promise you, this will not be easy. But if you do this, not only will you soon be rich and feel rich, you'll begin to have money in the bank and peace in your heart. Amen. You'll begin to have margin. It's not about how much you make, it's about how much margin you have. Now I'm going to make this even simpler for you. Here's a system, and remember, everybody else has a system for your money, so you should have a system for your money as well. And I would love you to take this system and learn how to live like it. It's a very, very, very simple system. In fact, it's so simple we've got a passion. I implemented this, and I'm not saying this, I'm just telling facts. I implemented this system in 2010, and it's what's allowed God to fulfill this vision He has given us to launch at the Odyssey Church in here in Sylvieville area. Now, what a shame. You think about it. What a shame it would be if God had to use somebody else to do what He's called me to do because I had the priorities of my finances upside down. What a shame it would be if God had to use somebody else to do what He's called you to do because your finances were out of priority. We're in the wrong order. So here's the plan. Simple as this. Give, save, live. Give, save, live. When you get paid, invest in God's kingdom first. Maybe you've heard this before. I lost place. I apologize. See, here's the thing. Rich people invest. Good rich people invest in God's first. And don't pick an amount, because God's not impressed with the amount. Pick a percentage. Now, Dan and I, we choose 10%. We choose 10% because the Bible speaks a lot about the tithe, and the tithe means 10%. And this is not for everybody. I'm not telling you this is for everybody. Okay, this is just me and my wife and what we decided. You work out whatever works for you, the best for you. But Dan and I chose 10%, and we chose 10% before taxes. The government takes off the top. We believe we should give off the top. Tithe means 10%. The Bible talks a lot about a tithe, so that we talked and we gave 10%. And actually, we believe in what we do, and again, this is not for everybody, I'm not telling you to do this, okay? This is just us. We give 10% to our local church first. We give 10% to the Odyssey, and what we give to others we consider an offering. There's a difference between a tithe and an offering. So really, we give more than 10%. Now, I'm not telling this to impress you. I'm telling this to press upon you that how important it is to us. And I know that 10% may not be realistic for most people in this room. I know that. And I don't think it's biblical or good advice to tell you a bar to live on so you can give to God. I don't think that's true. What I'm saying is, even if you have to start with 1%, even if you have to start with 2%, start with the percentage. Let's face it, if you make $300 a week, $3 to $6 ain't going to make a big difference. It ain't going to cause you not to eat or eat. If you're fortunate and you make $3,000 or $4,000 a week, $300 ain't going to make a big difference. Even if you're living right up to the edge. So start somewhere. Even if it's 1 or 2%, start with a percentage. And whatever percentage you decide to give to God's kingdom, give to your kingdom. You take 2%, give 2% to God, give 2% to your own. Put the same percentage you give into God's kingdom into a saving account or some other form of investment for your kingdom. And as you give more and save more, not only will you have more money in the bank, you'll have more peace in your heart because you'll have more margin. And then adjust your lifestyle accordingly. Give, save, live on the rest. Give, save, live on the rest. Give, save, live on the rest. If you're a Christian, you already know this is how you should prioritize your finances. When you prioritize your finances by putting God and His kingdom first, you are opening a door for God to come into your life, not shutting the door on God. When you give to God's kingdom first and save for your kingdom second and live on the rest, not only are you being good at being rich, you're being good as an ambassador of Christ, you're being good as a representative of the kingdom of God, you're being good as a good store of the riches which God so richly has provided for your enjoyment. You're being good at being rich by doing good works and by being a generous giver and a generous servant. But this ain't going to happen by accident. You have to pre-decide. And I don't tell you this to impress you, but to impress upon you how important this is. We couldn't do, Jan and I changed our lifestyle. We couldn't do the things we used to do. But we wanted to invite God and open the door to God in the area of our finances. We didn't want our stuff to have us. We didn't want what we own to own us. So we gave and we saved and we made lifestyle adjustments and we lived on the rest. And that is what allowed us to open up the Odyssey Church. And like I said, this isn't for everything. This was our personal decision. This was between me and God, and it's going to be between you and God. We give to our local church first, and then we started giving to the others. So we actually give more than 10%. And again, I tell you this, not to impress you, but to impress upon you, how important it is. You should, and if you don't, give to your local church. If you don't want to give anything here, oh, that's okay. We love you. That's not our point. Give to somebody. Give to somebody you believe in. It's about your heart. Just pick an organization you believe in, and then give them a percentage of your money. But giving has to be pre-decided, or you're not going to do it. And giving should be a percentage, because you can start giving away lots and lots of dollars and still be not be moving in God's direction, because you're giving more dollars, but you're giving away less of a percentage. And your giving should be progressive. If your lifestyle is getting better and your giving is the same as it was years ago, you're not being generous like God wants you to be generous. I think this is what God wants from us rich people. I think this is how you give like only rich people give. As we have more, we should serve more and give more. As we have more, the more you should do for God and others, and the more we should invest into God's kingdom. So I took the first week's statements, and I added another one. Then I'm going to read the first one, and if you do a real good job, I'm going to give you an incentive. If we all read this with enthusiasm, I'll pray and we get out of here, okay? God has blessed me with more than I need, so therefore I am rich. I will not place my hope in my riches, but in Him who richly provides. Since I have more, I should do more and give more. Make sense?
Yeah.
Reprioritize your finances, flip your list, give, save, live on rest. And if you do that, and it's very difficult ever you are, you'll have more money in the bank and more peace in your heart. And you'll have a richer life because you'll be able to live life as Jesus came to give. You'll be able to live life and live it more abundantly. So remember, give, save, live on rest. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you today, and I thank you for those that Lord, have sat through this. But Lord, this is just a message that has changed my life, changed my priorities, allowed you to come in my life and work in a way that I never even dreamed of. Made considerably less now than I've ever made in my life, and yet I have more peace in my heart because I have more money. Lord, if we would just ask to give, save, and live on a rest, reprioritize our list, Lord. Help us put you first. Father, as we leave here today, may we leave with your peace and your Son and shine your light to others that we come in. God bless each person in here. We love you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed. Thank you for staying.